This morning, though, we're going to look at this passage a little bit, but actually that's not going to be our, you know, we can take this passage and we go all kinds of different directions. We talk about evangelism, we can talk about, we can talk about missions, or being willing to go, which would make sense. We can talk about all kinds of different things, but the thing we're going to focus on this morning is, I think, a very important topic for us to look at as a church, as a congregation, and that's on baptism. One of the most exciting moments as a Christian came when I accepted Jesus as my Savior. And following that, after that, the next most exciting moment in my life as a Christian was when I had that opportunity to make that first public profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And what I'm referring to is baptism. When I was baptized, that was the first opportunity that I really had to tell everyone that what happened in my life. And it was an interesting moment. I was sharing with the Timothy Fellowship on Friday evening. We had a Bible study together. And as we were looking at salvation, I talked about my baptism. And when I was baptized, I was probably about the same size as Tammy, who was at the Bible study that evening. And the water was not that warm. In fact, all we used to warm up the water was a cattle trough heater. And you know what that is. Basically, that just warms up the water enough to keep the ice off it during the winter. It doesn't really warm up anything. And then I found out, to my chagrin, that we don't have a heater in our baptistry either. And the last church we had that didn't have a heater in it was at Faith Baptist Church. And we did the same thing you guys do. We let it warm up to room temperature. And I remember the first time I baptized someone in that baptistry, it was January, and it was an older lady, and she was this really thin, you know, this very elderly lady, and I don't think she stopped shivering through the whole service. But she was so excited about that opportunity to finally be able to express to the church what has happened in her life as she was baptized and was able to give testimony to what God and what Jesus Christ has done in her life. That's really what baptism is all about, and that's what I really want us to try to focus on this morning. You know, following that time, I was pretty nervous as a kid, and my dad had me stand on a brick, and he had to ask me some questions, because I was little, and I wouldn't even be able to see out. Our baptistry didn't have glass in front of it. So I remember watching glass baptisms, and Mandy isn't very tall either, so it's good that there's glass there, right, Mandy? But when I was baptized, I couldn't see out the top, so I'm standing on this brick, and as I get baptized, I go under, and I come back up, and you're just shivering like anything because the water's so cold. But I was so excited, and then following that, we come up in our services in our older church, the church I grew up in. We would have Lord's Supper right after following, and so that was the first opportunity that I had to have Lord's Supper too. So it was such a fantastic series of events that happened in my life. And you know, I think if you've come to faith in Christ, that is an amazing thing that you've done in your life. But if you haven't gone on to be baptized, you're missing out on another amazing opportunity in your life to express to all your friends and your family what Jesus Christ has done in your life. And in fact, you know, what I want us to look at is three questions really, is why is baptism so important, and who should be baptized, and when should we be baptized? So let's look at the first question though. Why is baptism so important? And if you look at Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, a very familiar passage to most of us, and that is the Great Commission. It's what Jesus commanded to his, gave it as a mission or a command to his disciples the day that he was going to ascend into heaven. Verse 19 says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." So I wanted to get a picture here is to see that it is why we baptize. It's put it simply, is that it is a command of Jesus for those who become his disciples. It's not an option. Jesus Jesus didn't say make disciples and if you feel like them, baptize them. He said make disciples and baptize them. So when we become believers in Jesus Christ, this is really the first commandment. The first command that Jesus gives to you as a believer. When you become a disciple, a follower of Christ, means that we are making a decision to follow what Christ has called us to do, commanded us to do. And the very first thing He's commanded you to do is to be baptized. So I want you to understand, though, it's not for the purpose of salvation that we're not talking about here. But it is to show that we are willing to be a disciple, willing to be a follower, willing to do whatever He's commanded us to do. So it's not, to me, as a believer in Jesus Christ, it's not an option whether or not we want to be baptized. It's whether or not we want to be a believer and be a follower of Jesus Christ, a disciple of Jesus Christ. If we look at Acts chapter 2, verse 38, in this passage here, we find some examples of how we want to of this following Him in baptism. I think I was the first one to get the cold from the mission trip, and I seem to be the last one to get rid of it at the moment. So all day on Friday, or evening on Friday at the Bible study, we did a series of questions. We had 25 true and false questions that we were going through. And every time I went to the next question, I said, now chapter 11, or now chapter 12. But I couldn't get in my head, it's question 12, question 11. So today, though, we're looking at chapter 2, Acts, verse 38 says, repent, Peter said to them, and be baptized, each of you in the name of Jesus the Messiah, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, he's not talking about that we're baptized for our remission of sins. We're to believe for our remission of sins and then follow Him in baptism. Jesus never said that when He said, go and make disciples, He didn't say, and then baptize them so they'd be saved. He's saying, baptize them in order to show a commitment to the Father. Verse 41 says, so those who accepted His message were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 people were added to them. So they were baptized right away. They didn't wait. They didn't put it off. They didn't hold off at all. And if we look at the chapter we're looking at this morning, in Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian didn't wait either. He says, as they were traveling down the road, they came to some water. The eunuch said, look, there's water. What would keep me from being baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, that you may. And he replied, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Then he ordered the chariot to stop, and both Philip and the eunuch went down to the water, and he was baptized him. Erickson says, Millard Erickson, one of the Baptist theologians, says, baptism then is an act of faith and a testimony. If you want to show what you believe, if you want to show that you have faith in Jesus Christ, your first job as a believer, I believe, as I understand Scripture, is that you go and be baptized. If you want to be one that is committed to Him, show that you are able to follow His first command to you as a disciple, and that is to be baptized. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 32 and 33, it tells us there, it's Jesus talking to His disciples. And in chapter 10, verse 32 and 33, it says, therefore, everyone who will acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father in heaven. This is a pretty good challenge to us. I think that what baptism shows to people who have come to faith in Jesus Christ, or shows to those around us, is that we truly acknowledge who Jesus Christ is in our life. That He is our Lord. That He is our Master. That He is our Savior. And that I'm willing and able to follow Him no matter what the command is, and I'll do exactly what He's commanded me to do, and that is to be baptized. And that's the first thing that, you know, I just want to keep going over there, just pushing that to you, and that is the first command that He's given to you. For the new believer in Jesus Christ, it's the first chance to proclaim to a large group of people what has happened in your life. If you refuse to be baptized, I ask you to think, what does your refusal action. Say about what you believe or your willingness to follow Jesus. Do you want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? And why wait to be baptized? Now, I know there's someone I've talked to, that even in our congregation, I understand there's some challenges for you. And I don't want to belittle those things. There's some of you that have family that aren't believers. And that's hard. But I also want to challenge you on the other side of that. And that is to say that even though we might have family that don't believe us, or don't believe what we believe, this is an opportunity to show that what Jesus Christ has done in your life, that He truly is Lord in your life. You know, my dad became a Christian, and I believe he's probably, of all this family, he's probably the only one that really has made Jesus Lord of his life. And when he went to become a pastor, he was told by his uncle, "Don't do it. You're making a mistake. You're not doing what you should be doing. You're not going to make any money doing that. You're not going to, you know." He had all kinds of things to say that would discourage him from following Jesus and being a pastor and following him into the ministry and being obedient. But I want you to see, though, that I'm so happy that my dad didn't do that, because I believe, like I told the mission team last week, or when I was able to speak, I don't believe I'd be standing here before you today if my dad was not willing to follow Jesus as a Savior and be willing to follow him into the ministry as a pastor. Now, that's a big step. Maybe God, I'm sure God could have done other things and could have worked out what he wanted to do through history, and that's not my job to decide what he could do or he can't do. But I would say that, boy, I would hate to see what would happen if my dad had not been faithful and followed Jesus Christ as a disciple of the Lord. We need to be willing to follow no matter what other people say or think. We need to be willing to stand up and give a testimony no matter what our family might even say to us. We just need to be willing and faithful. And to be a disciple, the first command that we're given is to follow him in baptism. Why be baptized? Because Jesus commanded us to. Who should be baptized? In Acts chapter 8, verse 37 again, we go back to our text, it tells us who should be baptized. It says, Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, you may." And he replied, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Who should be baptized? As Baptists, we believe that baptism is for those who have committed their selves, their lives to Jesus Christ. It is for those who have confessed that Jesus is Lord and want to follow him as a disciple. It's not for infants, but for those who have come to understand what Jesus has done and what he has completed upon the cross and through his resurrection. It is for those who wish to proclaim that God has done what God has done in their life through his Son, Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4 tell us this. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4 says, "Or are you unaware that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? Therefore we were buried with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Jesus Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may walk in the new life, a new way of life." Now, I had a hard time reading that because I've learned it in an old way of reading that, when King James. And when we baptize, we say, "Buried with him in the old, rise to walk in the newness of life." But that's my formula, so to speak, right? That's my tradition. So what is it? What it says is who's being baptized? Those who have gone, who have died to their old way of life, and they're rising to walk in a new way of life through Jesus Christ, who cleanses them from all their sins because of what he did on the cross, and the hope that comes through his resurrection. So baptism, then, is the perfect testimony of what Jesus has done in your life. It should be noted that baptism is not for salvation. It's strictly a testimony of that salvation that comes to your life through Jesus Christ. It's not for salvation, it is a result of salvation. This is why it is only meant for those who have confessed that Jesus is Lord and believe in their hearts. You know, you can say what you want and try to understand this. But from my understanding, from what I see in Scripture, that no matter, you know, I, as important as I believe baptism is, it is only an act or symbolizes what Christ has done in our life. And you need to understand that it's still an important step. And that's why, as a believer, you need to make that important step. So we go on to the last question that says, that I've asked is, when should we be baptized? Well, Acts chapter 8, verse 38, again, we see that what the Ethiopian did, he didn't wait at all. He says, well, then he ordered the chariot to stop, and both Philip and the eunuch went down in the water, and he was baptized. Acts chapter 2, verse 41, back there where we read earlier, it would say they believed, and then they were baptized. Acts chapter 10, verse 47 and 48, another example or testimony of baptism. And it says, and if you go start there and listen at the end of verse 46, it says, then Peter responded, can anyone withhold water prevent these from being baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And then he asked him to stay. Then they asked him to stay for a few days. These are great examples. There was no waiting time. There was no period of instruction. There was none of those kinds of things. They came to faith and they were baptized. So again, simply put, it's when we believe. There's no need for special knowledge to have. And all that is required is that you come to faith in Jesus Christ. And you know, I've heard of churches that require you to take membership classes first, which may be helpful, but it's not necessarily scripturally required. This is a manufactured requirement of men. There's no need to wait. We just need to be obedient. There's no need to put it off. We just need to simply follow His commands. You know, our church has times when we have joint services for baptism. But if we desire, as I talked to the senior pastor and talked to Pastor Ng, we're not limited to those times, but those are our special times that we encourage for times for baptism. That's Christmas and Easter. But when should you be baptized? When you're willing to show your willingness to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Remember, Jesus said, make disciples and baptize them. And then goes on to say, and teach them. So don't wait until you think you have enough knowledge or have enough understanding. Just be obedient. Baptism in the Baptist church is usually a prerequisite for membership in the church, but it's not a prerequisite for salvation. It just shows that you're willing to be obedient to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In our church, for a person that comes and asks to be baptized, we'll have some time with them, some time of instruction, so that we make sure that they have an understanding of what they are doing. But that's all that's for. And when we sit down and talk about it, but don't let that keep you from being obedient to the Lord. We'll ask you, I think probably part of the hardest part of baptism is that you have to give your testimony. If you ask Doug and Mandy, those are the ones I got to see from our congregation. But that's a challenging part. You have to put together what you believe, what you come to understand. But again, it's just an opportunity to share with the brothers and sisters of our church and the Chinese Baptist Church that Jesus Christ has truly come into your life. And that's why you're following in baptism. That's why you're being obedient to enter into the waters of baptism with Him. Will you consider this? Will you think about this? Will you be willing to share with your church? But don't let this hold you back. Don't be afraid of what people might think. Don't be afraid of the water. Don't be afraid that it's going to be too cold. Don't let any of these kind of things get in the way. Over 30 years ago, a 7-year-old boy came forward at his church and received Jesus Christ in his heart and followed him in baptism. It is day that is as fresh. It is a day that is as fresh today as it was then. I can remember everything about it, about that evening I was baptized. I can remember sitting in the front row of the church, in the front pew, anticipating that great moment when my dad said, asked the candidates to go and prepare themselves for baptism. I can remember standing at the edge of the baptistry thinking, I could hardly wait to get that opportunity. I could hardly wait to stand in front of all those people, even this 7-year-old, almost 8-year-old boy, and say, look, I know that God has changed my life, and I want to profess to you as a church that He's done amazing things for me. That's why we be baptized. That's why we're baptized. Will you be obedient to the command of your Lord to be baptized as a disciple of Jesus Christ? Will you be obedient and follow Him as your Master and Savior? Will you be a disciple of Him? Will you not let the world